Yes, and I mean, of course, there's so much material here, so it's hard to capture all the projects sort of within one frame. I like to still just open for more sort of general a question before we sort of open questions from the room, and we also might have some questions online, and these might apply, of course, to the individual projects as well, so some more general concern. I thought it was sort of really inspiring, and of course, there's given the context and framework of this particular meeting that has the name of knowledge and maybe working with border between knowledge and non-knowledge. I think I would just I just felt that it could be interesting to just sort of open the floor with the question sort of if these the question of knowledge that has also been addressed by speakers earlier today, sort of regarding sort of the concepts of knowledge within sort of an artistic research project, how that would resonate within your projects. And I just leave it open so anyone can grab the word, yes?
Yeah, so that makes me think about that. Actually, there was one serious flaw in my presentation because I said that Heinrich Schenker, there were two great influences on him, and I spoke about the organicist philosophy of Goethe, but I didn't mention the other influence on Schenker, and that is Freudian psychoanalysis. So Schenker essentially is trying to psychoanalyze the music. And the ideas of Schenker, such as the Ursatz, the fundamental structure that I spoke about, they are very, very similar to Freud's notion of the unconscious, because we can't, since you can't see them and you can't measure them, in what sense do we know that they exist? And so for me, the truth value of Schenkerian theory, it's not necessarily scientific empirical truth value that I'm looking for. I'm looking for the instrumental truth value in expanding my vision of the music. So that's one example of alternative notions of knowledge, that the knowledge derived from Schenkerian theory, it's certainly very disputed whether it can be called knowledge, and we need to develop the idea of what we call knowledge.
I just thought about, it was mentioned earlier, I think, but that for me the dilemma in this whole artistic research is to, that you have, I mean, I have my film practice going on at one, that's how I do it, at one site, so that runs. And then I have the feeling that I want to redevelop something in this project that is a real research project, like an artistic, what we call my own practice, my own art practice, and then at the same time I want to see if that can meet the theory, if you understand what I mean. I think that's like a very complex way, and that's why I'm still struggling with this. And I think that's just very interesting in also this whole talk about linearity, or how you deal with stuff and how you try to combine stuff at the end. And what is the end in this? That's the biggest question. What is actually the end, and how far do you go in the process before you decide where to put it, or what? I mean, talking about the text, do you need to deliver text on this, or do you need to? I think that's a big issue. Yeah. Mm.
Yeah, I think so. So it's really. This idea that the knowledge is in the words is, of course, I think somebody today talked also about this idea that it's in the words. And of course, with every artistic practice, everybody knows that it is not only in the words, it's in the different doings also. Mm. And when I did my last report, on my last artistic research, which was a pilot for this one, there was a moment where I really tried to write like an academic theorist, and it was just not working. Mm. And also for me not working. And I just felt like I'm entering a field that I just don't have the knowledge of. So that's actually one reason why I try here to, and I think I'm not done with it at all, but I try to reconnect the writing to the artistic practice so that there is a field of openness, which is maybe a little bit unprecise, maybe sometimes emotional or poetic, or addresses other forms of knowledge. So, yeah.
I also feel that this question that why these presentations, even though they're so diverse, sort of seem to circle around the same question of sort of how to produce knowledge and setting up sort of structural way of engaging with things. And at least sort of from a listener perspective, you really want to sort of scrutinize sort of what is happening. Sort of, I was thinking, for example, when in your presentation, and Andreas, when you talk about this waiting, sort of how the waiting leads to writing. And you know, and then the question of sort of but what are the what are the methods of writing? I mean, what are the rules that you then have to invent in order to produce things? And I think the same way that also when you present this dialogue with different stakeholders and the panels, it becomes an interesting way where you sort of it becomes this a really interesting sort of a box where something happens inside it, and it's amazing to gain insight into sort of how this unfolds. And I think the same with this Schenkerian and this structural model that you set up, where you could go through a practice that would then eventually lead to a Deleuzian sort of working with materials according to and try to open up to what cannot sort of be. Foreseen, sort of. And I think, sort of, in that way, it's sort of, there's kind of a point there that I think is strikingly sort of different takes on the same kind of question or the same kind of sort of problem. And I find that sort of really sort of inspiring. So with the limited time, I was just sort of one question that I was would like to sort of also sort of hand you before we open to the to audience questions. Sort of was the question of the institutional context where your projects unfolding, and that's just sort of general interest, also reflecting the projects that's been described earlier today. To what extent sort of does the institutional context that these projects are developed within sort of allow or stimulate or also delimit the projects that you are creating?
You mean what you bring back to the institution you're in, or how you use them in?
I'm curious. I mean, you mentioned this that you want to bring back the knowledge somehow in a teaching situation. And still, sort of, you also reflect sort of a kind of an ecosystem of how films are produced that also seems to as a trigger for your project. Yeah.
But I mean, very like personal. For example, when I went to the film school, I had the wish that there was somebody in between, somebody that had this influence from visual art and also understood film, that would be an open field. So I am a teacher at the film school from time to time. And this is, I mean, that's what I mean with trying to create a language, because I'm not sure I even know what it means myself to create a language, but to make some, is just to see if there is there some, if we could communicate better what we're actually doing when we try to research for something. That would be something I would like to bring back to the students, to see. It's not really to measure your audience in that kind of sense, because I'm doing that also. I'm also like delivering out my pieces, and then I'm trying to have feedback from audience. But that's another thing. It's more to see if I can, for example, I will be too long. But I was at a meeting at the broadcast, Danish television the other day, and they would ask for me, why do you need to have this kind of visual language? Why do you need to clean the space and make it white to bring people in, like the cast in there? And I just thought if I had a better description on why and what it adds to the language, then I'm sure they would actually eat it, if you understand what I mean. So I feel that it develops me, and then I can maybe bring it back to the way that we talk about our work, to be more actually, not theoretical, but know what we're doing, at least afterhand.
I understood your question as, how does the institutional frame shape the work I'm doing, right?
Doing research is part of artistic process, sort of in general.
But definitely, it takes me. The fact that I'm doing this work within an institutional frame of education creates another, for example, another temporality of the work. As this was a work that I had time. I mean, not full time, of course, but the project time frame was 2 years, which is absolutely exceptional. Normally, I work as a freelancer, so you have short-time projects, and you have to, even if you work with a research-based practice, you have to deliver the results in a pretty short time. So this is definitely, regarding to waiting, a very, very important influence of the institution. And I try to, regarding the work that basically, I don't separate it so much from the other artwork I'm doing, but still this temporality is for me the most important difference, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. So to use the phrase "not only," which is the theme today, I see my project as not only being as contributing with ideas of how to use Schenkerian theory in performance, but also to give a very loving critical dialogue with the state of things in the music community and also at my school, the Royal Academy of Music. So we speak a lot about opening an ethical space for a more creative type of performer, and I see that not only as operating in terms of the music society, but also personally for a musician like myself, who has been brought up under the influence of this Werktreue ideology, and that really dictates what is even possible to imagine, you know, what kind of music we can think of. So it's not only for the community in which I operate, but also for myself, it's necessary to focus on the opening of such an ethical space for creativity. So I mentioned today the opera performance where on stage there was used as a prop a MacBook computer, but the musicians in the pit played exactly in the way, or attempted to play in the way that the music would have sounded in the 18th century. When I made a similar presentation at the Music Academy, I spoke about the difference between how we interpret the plays of Shakespeare, how they are performed today, and the music of Beethoven, because Shakespeare and Beethoven, they have a similar status in the history of literature or of theater and music respectively, and yet there's such a great difference. So I see it like a kind of important task to just encourage more creativity in developing ways to perform classical music, because if we see like how Shakespeare is performed today and compared to how Beethoven is performed, it seems rather obvious that if we would be just as open to innovative performances in Beethoven, we can look forward to very great experiences in the future, because nobody has explored these things yet. So there's a huge expanse of artistic land which has not been developed at all. So it's in that sense a very positive message.
Yes, I would like to open the floor for questions.
I wanted to ask Karina about the aesthetics of your presentation. So you were using a research catalog here, and I wanted to ask, was it made intentionally for this presentation, or are you also using this research catalog to convince your funding bodies to support you? Because, yeah, I was also thinking it has some certain aesthetics, the way you lay out all the things.
And the whole research catalog thing, or just the video, or the research catalog?
Research catalog.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Mm. No, I'm using it for. I'm, it's just my own way of structuring things, because again, this ideas about, and it develops all the time. So I'm just thinking, like, how can you, because I've been looking at lots of projects in this artistic research catalog, and I also was helping like one from the theater school, you don't call that, like for stage art, to develop her project, like visually. So I've tried to think, how can you creatively end up with, I would definitely not write an essay, that's not my way of thinking. But can I use this structure as a sculpture, you know, if you understand? And you can move around more fluently than I did today, because you can like make, you can like make people jump from one point to another point. You can make like quite precise directings in, if that makes sense.
So if you want to convince somebody, you don't write a text, but you send the link to research catalog.
Yeah, okay.
No, I'm asking you.
No, I don't know. if I want to convince someone about the project, no, then I think for now they need a description. I mean, I don't think you can look around in my catalog without help right now. At least without being directed. I don't know. What do you think?
No, I think it's really a good tool if you want to convince somebody to get some funding, or I don't know, to get into a festival or to go somewhere else. I mean,
I'm just thinking
to represent with rich media.
But I'm just thinking about that this could be like a final result if I refine it, you know? That could be my deliverance for like an artistic project.
I think in all the diversity of these presentations, it's interesting to kind of also note that we shifted somehow throughout the day from this more PhD doctorate focus to what you mentioned also, Andreas, the educational. So when you mentioned the institutional, you kind of translated it to the educational. I think a lot of these projects within the KUV sphere, also in Karina's project, of course, has this quite intimate link to how are we educating in the arts in the different disciplines. That's more like an observation. Feel free to say something more about it. I was more kind of interested in the, I don't know if you could explore a bit the relationality in your projects and the ethics thereof, was mentioned by Emil. And in Andreas' projects, I was thinking this translation to a kind of a third person, and what I also perceived as a slightly ironic narrative, and how you would kind of let this meet the people you worked with. and if you could, perhaps it's mostly to Andreas, to kind of explore a little bit how those relations you established are now translated into the form you presented here, and if you want to take that back somehow to Tornby as well. Now you presented us this. I'm wondering about that particular thing in your project. I think overall there was something about in relation to not only and beliefs and organicity, as Emil was talking about, which was really interesting, that there was this kind of opening up to relations outside of the work and outside of earlier works, which maybe we can explore, but first Andreas, maybe. Thank you.
One thing that I experienced in this work in Tornby is that the questions there with performative practices, the questions are so basic that I actually, if I would start to deal with groups of audience or groups of participants and work about these problems of the third medium and stuff, it would just not really fit to the actual situation, because I have the feeling the first thing is actually to build relations that create the possibility for an artistic encounter at first. And so what I actually did regarding methods, I was more setting up very simple situations of presence where I would just be there, like I said in the text, offering coffee or offering a lecture or offering a workshop. But I could not at all, or not very much, think about anything that is mediated outside. And now, while you ask me, I think right now I'm actually exactly doing this. By writing this text, I'm creating this third medium. I just understood actually right now. So, it will be interesting to come back. Yeah, there are a lot of difficult questions, for example. I mean, I'm using now the stories and the people in the narrative. I make them mine by taking them into my narrative. Can I do this? Do I have to ask them if I'm allowed to do it? How much must I fictionalize in order to be free? How to deal with it? I really don't know. So I'm in this process, and I'm afraid to bring it back to Tornby right now, in the state where it is. And I think before I can bring it back, I need to be really clear what's the approach, so that I welcome people into the world, and I will be want to be responsible, and still I want to be very subjective in the way I read it. So I think I'm conflicted. This is the typical conflict of a performance artist engaging with real people, and I'm really not free of that.
I think what it sounds like you're doing is kind of sort of from another world, in the lines of rematerializing a sculpture, maybe without the politics so much. But in visual arts, there's actually laws governing a sculpture's or an artwork's right. So you're not allowed to rematerialize or just put a little cap on a sculpture. I mean, people do it, but they are actually protected. And what I'm just curious, because I don't know your world. How is the response to rematerializing, or what should we call it, to working with Beethoven in this way?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question, and it has very profound, of course, philosophical issues connected to the basic ontology of music. So in the analytic tradition, philosophers debate whether musical works exist at all, since the work as such doesn't exist in space and time. Beethoven's scores exist as paper, and musical performances exist as events that occur in time. But it's not clear in what sense that the work exists as an abstract entity. So what I've been concerned about is the feeling of ethical obligations to the composer. So as a classical musician, we do feel that we are obliged to perform the music of the composer in the correct way. And that's why in one of my slides I mentioned that actually it should be a question of aesthetics and not of morals or a legal matter. I mean, it's not like you can get a fine for making a bad performance of Beethoven. Maybe you will not be invited to play a concert the next time, but that's of course a problem. But it's difficult to see that there should be any ethical obligations in performing the work of a composer who died a long time ago. But then I completely agree that in a sense we are trying to rematerialize, or what is the term that's used in
rematerialize
the music. But the question is that it's not clear what the material is. So since the particular concrete object that we are working with, that is sound waves that occur in time. And certainly every time you perform a work, that's a new instance of materializing that work. But the question is, what sort of thing is the work? So what we are trying to do is to say that there exist abstract tone structures, and we are trying to instantiate those in a new way, in a way that will communicate in a powerful way to the modern audience. So we accept that there exist abstract tone structures, but we discard the conventions that regulate how we are supposed to perform those sound structures. So that's my approach, that we operate with a practical view of the existence of works, but we try to, for this particular project, to not look at all the conventions surrounding how to deal with those structures. But this is a very complicated philosophical question, you can hear.
First of all, say thank you so much for the presentations. Yeah, it was super rich and inspiring, so I'll look forward to follow that as they develop. And yeah, thank you all for participating. Thank you.